Good morning. I was transfixed by that song. I forgot I was supposed to walk up here, so that was very good. What a reminder, too, that as we've been going through this series in Revelation, that's what it's all about, right? We want Jesus, and so it's a cool connection for today. Today's another special day. We're continuing our series in Revelation. Pastor Buddy's going to be preaching today, and I am very excited to hear your message, brother. What a blessing it is. We get to be here. We get to fellowship with each other, with the saints, and also, most importantly, with our God. So if you would pray with me, we're going to get started this morning in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you so much for this morning. Lord, thank you for all that you give us. Lord, thank you that we get to come and worship you. Lord, thank you that in the midst of all of the trials, the persecution, the pain, everything we go through, we get to, at the end of the day, pray that we'd get to receive you. Lord, that we would pursue you and inherit eternal life with you. Lord, we don't want to live just for living. We want to live to be with you. Lord, I thank you so much for the promises you give us, that in the midst of being called to repentance in many of these churches, we're also told that if we overcome through the blood of Christ, we inherit life with you forever. And that is a beautiful promise, Lord. Lord, I pray that you give Pastor Buddy the words to say today, give him clarity, help us to listen and receive well, Lord, that we wouldn't just expect to be told what to do, but Lord, that the Spirit would work in our lives in ways that would transform us into the image of your Son. I thank you for everything you give us. I pray that we listen well. I pray this in Jesus' precious and holy and sovereign name. Amen.
Amen. Good morning, church family. Let's stand and worship together. Amazing grace this morning. Let's sing this out. Who breaks the power?
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth?
Amen.
Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Come on.
questions this morning. Psalm 27:13, it says, I believe that I shall look upon the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Amen. See, God is so good and so faithful and so consistent in this chaotic world. I know we've probably thought that and prayed that this week in the chaos of the hurricane, God. I'm just so thankful that we're able to worship. And let's just sing about his goodness.
Yeah. Amen. Let's pray together. Father God, we just thank you for an opportunity to be here in this place, dear God, that you have provided. We thank you for an opportunity to come together, Father, to fellowship and to embrace each other and warmness, Father, because we love each other. But we also come this morning, Father, when we hear your word proclaimed from the pulpit today, and may your spirit move mightily amongst us today. Draw us, dear God, closer to you. Father, we pray for those that may be hurting in our congregation, and Father, for those that are celebrating joys in our congregation today. Help us, Father, brothers and sisters of Christ, just love on each other. I pray this morning, Father, that your spirit move amongst us today and draw us closer and closer and closer to you. May your will be done. Help us to remember, Father, as we gather together today to worship here in this place where we're worshiping before the very throne room of heaven. And we thank you, Father, for that honor and that privilege. May you hear our prayers today, Father, the ones that are spoken and ones that may be unspoken. For in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. Well, that starts it off right, don't it? Maybe we'll just leave it right there. Yeah, it's one of the first times I'd ever preached before. I was at Berea Baptist Church, and I like to use my hands a lot, and I made good today. I got to swinging my hands and snatched the microphone and the thing right off my belt. It went flying out into the congregation out there, and of course, I got a big mouth. I never slowed down or stopped to preach. And so I'm privileged to be here this morning, and I will tell you the truth. I'm a little apprehensive. In the 10 years that I pastored, I never preached from the book of Revelation. I preached from a lot of the other books, but Revelation is not one that I felt drawn to preach from. When asked by Pastor Kristen to join in this endeavor, I said yes, and so I hope and pray this morning you'll get something out of the message. But as I prepared for it, one of the things I was thinking about was the letter in itself is the book that we call the book of Revelation. And the reason why I got to thinking about it is because, you know, this was revealed to John, and John put this down in writing. But then I wonder, how did the churches get it? You know, it's because it was written to seven churches, but also written for us. But how did they get it? I mean, did he take it and write it and make copies of it? Did he take it down to wherever and have Xerox copies made of it so all the church had their copies? And then, was it just a scroll? Was a scroll sent from church to church to church? And sometimes I just think about these weird things. I mean, did the church get it in one of those cardboard sleeves like you get from the post office? And, you know, and they open it up and they shook it out, and the pastor of church says, "Whoa, we got a letter from John." And then he goes down and reads through the letter and realizes this is not a letter from John, this is a letter from God. And then I wonder what would his reaction have been? I'm getting it right. What would the church's reaction have been when the pastor received the letter? Would it have been a sense of awe when he had called the elders together and read from the word, or called the church together? And I just have a sense there had to be a feeling of an overwhelming awe that receiving a letter from God. You know, the word may have come through John, but the word was from God. And I wonder what it would be like for us to receive that type of letter ourselves today here at Bethany. But I don't have to wonder. We did receive the letter. And I just wonder sometimes, churches, we take what's in Scripture that we have received, New Testament, Old Testament, if we take it in the way that we should take it, with a sense of awe. That the person who created the very universe that we live in, that separated the light from the darkness and the earth from the seas and hung the stars in the sky, wrote us a letter. Do we take it the way it's intended to be taken? We have many opportunities to have many copies of God's word in our house, and I just wonder if when we read it, we really understand who's the author. And do we take that by heart? And so this morning I have two churches that I would like to cover today. It'll be the Church of Sardis and the Church of Philadelphia, which is in chapter 3. And so this morning, if you turn to your Bibles to the last book of the Bible and go to chapter 3, which is located between 2 and 4, I'll give you some help. And we're going to read this morning from the two churches. It'll also be up here on the screen behind me, or you can look at it on your phone and app. I want to read through the verses first and then go back and address some things in it. So join me this morning at chapter 3, verse 1 in Revelation. It says, "To the angel of the church in Sardis write, these are the words of him who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. Now, I know your deeds. You have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead. Wake up. Strengthen what remains and is what about to die. For I have not found your deeds complete in the sight of my God. Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard. Obey it and repent. But if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what time I will come to you. Yet you have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their clothes. They will walk with me, dressed in white, for they are worthy. He who overcomes will, like them, be dressed in white. And I will never blot out his name from the book of life, but will acknowledge his name before my Father and his angels. He who has an ear, let him hear." And the Spirit says to the churches. May God bless the reading of his word this morning. As I look here at the very beginning of the letter, it's somewhat different from the other letters that we have received, because in the other letters, he starts out maybe with some words of commendation, things that they have done well, and then he had proceeded from there. And this morning, you'll see right away that it's not true in the letter to the church of Sardis. He goes on to say, "I know your deeds. You have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead." And so I read this scripture the first. It's like, what makes a dead church? When he says they're dead, what does that mean? When he says that you have a reputation, by the way, so it must have been that they were doing some things, but they were dead in doing those things. And so I try to determine what makes a dead church, and you know, I really kind of came up with two things in my mind. Is a dead church is a church who don't know Christ to start with. I mean, could it not be that there's a church that's doing all the right things? They have the VBS, and they're doing, you know, Mission Week, and they got Bible studies, and they got small groups, and they got, you know, all the ladies got a 9 by 13, you know, dish, casserole dish, by the way, which is a requirement for Baptists. And so maybe they're doing all these things, but somewhere's in there, there is no personal relationship between the people that are gathered together in God. And it makes them dead. Because all life can only be found through Jesus Christ. And so it made me think today, do we have those in our congregations or in our churches today that are dead? I'm mindful of a lady I spoke to many years ago. And she came up to me and she said, and she was an older lady. She said, "Pastor Buddy, I don't know if I really know Jesus Christ." I said, "Well, we can pray right now. You accept Christ as your Lord and Savior." And she said, "But do I need to come forward into church?" I said, "Yes, ma'am. You got to come forward and be baptized." She says, "But I'll be embarrassed." She had been serving in the church in different capacities for 35, 40, 45 years and realized that she did not have a personal relationship with our Lord and Savior. And it makes me wonder this morning, do we have those in our churches today that are dead to Christ? They've said the right words. They've studied the Bible. They know who he is. But let me tell you something. Satan knows him too. They belong to all the committees. Perfect attendance week, a year has been marked on their calendar. But they've never had a personal relationship with our Lord and Savior. So I thought maybe that's what they was talking about having a dead church. Is that we have those that come to the churches today because it's cool to be there. They like the programs, they like the music, and the message is pretty cool on Sunday mornings. They like the fellowship, they like the potluck dinners, but somewhere in there they have never had a relationship with Lord Jesus. I believe that makes a dead church. And then I thought maybe it's not that they didn't have a relationship. Maybe they started out in the right place. But somewhere along that journey, they had pulled away. Somewhere along that journey, they have lost their passion and their relationship with Christ. I want you to understand, when you become saved, you're going to get all the Spirit you're going to get. The Bible says we're created a new creature in Christ. But through that journey of life, there are times when that passion for Christ will burn brighter. And there will be times when it's not, usually because of sin in our lives. We can draw away. Do you know we can squelch the Spirit of God in us by our lifestyles and the things that we do? Sometimes it's just because we get lazy, or sometimes we start conforming to the culture of the world and we become dead. I think I shared with the pastors in our meeting that day is that it's like that couple that you know, they were so in love and they got married and had children, and over the next 20, 25 years, life is busy and they're working two jobs and they're raising kids and they're going to sports camp and all these things are happening. And finally, the last child is out the door, and they're sitting across the breakfast table from each other, and they do not know who that person is on the other side of the table. Because somewhere along the journey there, they got so busy doing other parts of life, they failed to keep kindle the relationship that they would have with each other. So it makes me wonder this morning when he talks about here about a dead church, is it because the church knew him intimately at one time but have drifted apart? And they no longer cherish that relationship that they had. And God wants a close, intimate relationship with us. And maybe that's what made the dead church. I mean, the reputation was good. But now they're dead. I told them it's like the old guys that driving the pickup truck. Now, I will tell you this morning, church, that I think the one thing that has hurt our romance in our lives is putting bucket seats in a pickup truck. We need bench seats to come back. Y'all remember, right, when you went to pick up your girlfriend, you didn't open the passenger's door, you opened the driver's door, she scooted in just enough room for you to get in here beside her. And if you were falling behind him, you couldn't tell who was driving. And so the old farmer was driving one day, and his wife was sitting on her side, and he's sitting on his side, and they're driving down the road, and she looks at him, and she says, "You know, we don't sit beside each other anymore." He thinks for a moment, he says, "I didn't move." I didn't move. And I think that's true of our relationship with Christ. Amen? Christ didn't move, people. You scooted over in the truck. And so when they're addressing Sardis this morning about being the dead church, I think that so many of us today need to get in the truck and scoot back over. Because we can do all these things for Christ, but also why we're doing it. And our love for Christ. 1 Corinthians 13, 1 through 3, it says, "If I speak in the tongues of men of angels, but I do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have the gift of prophecy and cannot fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all possessions to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast but do not have love, I've gained nothing." And I think sometimes we're nothing more than clanging cymbals. It is important what we do, but it's more important why we do it. Is what Scripture is teaching us this morning. So on one hand, we may have a body of believers here that are dead because they had a relationship, but no longer close to that relationship. So all that they do is like clanging cymbals. Or we may have some in that church that never really knew Christ to start with. Matthew 7:21 says, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven." The letter to the church of Sardis, he calls them a dead church. So in verse 2, it says, "Wake up, strengthen what remains and what is about to die, for I have not found your deeds complete in the sight of God. Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard, obey it and repent.
But if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what time I will come. So there's still hope here in God's word here. He's telling them that they could repent and rekindle that relationship and become a live church again. But there's a sense of urgency here that tells them to wake up. And I believe that same sense of urgency should be upon our churches today. It's time for the churches to wake up and to become alive. I will tell you right now, people are looking for a place to come and to be loved on and cared for. They're looking for a place, a body of believers that can help them in their loneliness. We're living in a lost and dying world today, and it's time for the churches to wake up. This is our opportunity. God has placed us here at a reason, at this time in history, in this nation for a reason. It's time for the churches to wake up and love God's people the way God intended, to be a live church and not a dead church. Not just a church that has programs and dinners and mission trips and all the other things that go with it, but a church that truly loves God. And the warning here is for the church to wake up. He goes on in 4 and says, "Yet you have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their clothes. They will walk with me dressed in white, for they are worthy. He who overcomes will, like them, be dressed in white. And I will never blot out his name from the book of life, but will acknowledge his name before my Father and his angels. And he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." He recognizes here in Scripture that there are some that are still walking the path that God has laid out before them. He talks about him being dressed in white, which symbolizes salvation and righteousness. He said he will overcome, or those that overcome will be like them. I think Eric broke it out about all these messages are about overcoming. All about overcoming. You see, the title of my message today is "The Main Thing is Making the Main Thing the Main Thing." Y'all can write that down. The main thing is making the main thing the main thing. In other words, the main thing is Jesus Christ. So the main thing is making the main thing Jesus Christ the main thing. And in the church of Sardis, they failed to do that. They were dead because Jesus Christ was not the main thing. But fortunately, we have another church this morning. The Church of Philadelphia. So this morning, if you turn in your Bibles to chapter 3, verse 7, and I'll read through verse 13. "And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these are the words of him who is holy and true, who holds the key of David. What he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open. He says, I know your deeds. See, I have placed before you an open door that no one can shut. I know what you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. I will make those who are of the synagogue of Satan, who claim to be Jews, though they are not, but are liars. I will make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I have loved you. Since you have kept my command to endure patiently, I will also keep you from the hour of trial that is going to come upon the whole world to test those who live on the earth. Verse 11, I am coming soon. Hold on to what you have so that no one will take your crown. Him who overcomes, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. Never again will I leave it. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which is coming down out of the heaven from my God. And I will also write on him my new name. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." So the letter from Philadelphia is also a little bit different, that there is nothing at the beginning of it that he finds complaint with the church of Philadelphia. Now, Philadelphia is located just about 25 miles from Sardis, and this city had an imperial road running through it, and it was in part of a great vine-growing district, lots of leather and textiles industry. And I bring this up this morning because it was known as a strong and wealthy city at the time the letters were written. If you look at the verse up there, it says, at verse 7, it says, These are the words of him who is holy and true, which is God, and who holds the key of David. And when I try to do a little research on this, and it seems like that comes from Isaiah 22:20, when in the Old Testament the key was given to like a chief of staff to another chief of staff, or for one king gives his authority by passing a key to someone else. And so in this verse here, it gives us the idea that Jesus has the key. He has the authority over the church. Because then he goes on to talk about he opens the door and closes the door, and no one but him can open and close that door. That Jesus is the authority of the church, and that authority has been given to Christ through God himself. We need to recognize that Christ is to be acknowledged as the author of all liberty and opportunity in his church. I think when it talks about opening and closing the doors, it's talking about opening and closing the kingdom of God. And for us to get into the kingdom of God, there's only one way. That's through Christ Jesus. And we will see here in just a minute when he talks about the synagogues of Satan, you need to understand that the church here is being persecuted by Jews at this time. And the Jews have closed their door to them. As a matter of fact, if you read from Paul or read some from John, he'll say the only true Jews were the Jews that had accepted the Messiah as the Christ, as Jesus Christ. And the false Jews are ones who have not accepted him as the Christ. He says, "You have kept my word and have not denied my name." And so, I, again, like Sardis, I was trying to think what made the Church of Philadelphia different from the Church of Sardis. It talked about having little strength, which gives you the idea that probably wasn't as a populous church. It probably didn't have as many members in the congregation. But yet, they're being commended for staying faithful to God. So what was the difference between the two? And I believe it all comes down to what I call the heart. In Sardis, the people served and did things but had no heart. But in Philadelphia, they were all heart. They were serving their God and serving their community for the right reason. They had a personal relationship with Christ. The comparison between the two is that in Philadelphia, they knew what the main thing was. And they were keeping the main thing, the main thing. Verse 9 says, "I will make those who are of the synagogue of Satan, who claim to be Jews, though they are not, but are liars, I will make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I have loved you, since you have kept my command to endure patiently." And I'll stop before I read the rest of that. It talks about here that he will actually have them, the synagogue of Satan, people recognizing. I don't believe it's really talking about them literally coming down and bowing down, but I believe what has been taught here in Scripture is we do the things that God wants us to do, even those that hate us will come to recognize the power of God in our lives. All right, we can't return hate with hate. We return hate with love. And if we live truly the way that God intends us to live, like it does, what they say here in Philadelphia, if we live and love the people the way God loves people, if we see people the way God sees people, if we extend a hand of grace to God's people, even those that despise us and hate us will come to understand the power of God in our lives. Because we know at one point in time, every knee will bow before God Almighty. So his promise here is you continue to do what you're doing, and even those that despise you will come to recognize Christ in your life, and Christ in your church. If we want to be a great church in this community, if we want to be a great church in this country, in this state, what we need to do is simply love Jesus and love each other. And even those that are our distractors will have to recognize the love that we have. Unfortunately, today, too many of us as Christians, we lash out at those things that we don't like, and not responding the way God would have us to respond, and that's through love. The very things that people do that turn my stomach, I have to stop and realize the same Jesus that died for me died for them. The same Jesus. And I am to love them like Jesus loved me. And when we do that, it's like heaping coals on their heads when we love the way Jesus loves. And that was what he was telling in here in the church that was being persecuted by the Jews. He says, simply walk the path that you are walking. Walk the path that you are walking. And they will acknowledge you and fall down at your feet. Verse 10 says, since you have kept my command to endure patiently, I will also keep you from the hour of trial that is going to come upon the whole world to test those who live on earth. Reading this, there are commentators here that believe this is referring to the tribulation. And that may be true. I'm just not smart enough to figure that part out. But I also believe what is also true here is God's promise to us, even in times of trial, He will be with us. Our salvation is secured in Christ. Nothing can remove us from that. I believe He was telling the church here that even in these trials, I'm with you. Even in the trials of having health issues, I'm with you. Even in the trials of having economic issues, I'm with you. Through all these. As a matter of fact, in John 17:15, Jesus prayed, my prayer is not you take them out of the world, but you protect them. So when I read this scripture, I don't see this scripture just saying He's going to remove us from all things. He will just be with us through all things. And we will be protected. Our faith is assured. Our salvation is assured through Christ Jesus. He's telling them, even the church, the churches of Satan who are trying to lock their doors against them, can never shut my doors. My doors of salvation. Verse 11, I am coming soon. Hold on to what you have so that no one will take your crown. You know, I read this and praying about what it refers to when it talks about taking our crown. Number one is, I know I believe that once you're saved, you're always saved, and nothing can remove you from the hand of God. Nothing can uncreate the creation that God has created in you when you become saved. But what does this mean when He says it could take our crowns? And I believe it goes back to storing those treasures in heaven. The scripture tells us that we're to store treasures in heaven, not treasures on earth. And what do those treasures look like? Those treasures in heaven are the places where we've been obedient to God. Those treasures in heaven are relationships that we have built and that we had lifted up, and people that we have prayed for, that we have led into a saving grace of Jesus Christ. Those treasures in heaven are when we extend the hand of grace to a brother or sister. The hands of grace, the treasures in heaven, are when we clothe the cold and feed the hungry. And all these things that we do, if we do them in the name of God, are being stored for us in heaven. And I think the warning here is that we need to keep our eyes in that direction and continue on. Because it'll be so easy for the world to come in. And as Eric said the other day, we start to make small steps away from the Word of God that is straight and narrow. And soon we become like the world. And I think what he's telling us here, telling the church here, is keep on the straight and narrow. Because if you don't, if you start chasing the world, you start chasing culture, those treasures will be taken away from you. Guys, what we do here matters. What we do here is important. James teaches us that our faith is dead without works. Works are important. But it's why we're doing the works that's more important. The thing we have, what thing that we do here could impact our children and our grandchildren. What we do here can impact our community. What we do here can impact the people that you live with and in the areas that you go to work with. It's important that we keep on being faithful to God and being obedient to God in the direction He has us to go. Philadelphia was that type of church. But we don't need to be distracted by the world. And the world can distract us. He tells us in His Word here, be careful. To hold on to what you have so that no one will take your crown. But then here comes a promise in His Word. I'm coming soon. I'm coming soon. Now, I don't know what soon is. How soon Jesus is coming back. But I also understand I may not have no promise of tomorrow. Something could happen when I leave the church today or tomorrow. I need to live my life to the fullest to glorify God today, because I do not know when my time will come. There may not be any other tomorrows. Him who overcomes, in verse 12, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. Never again will I leave it. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem, which is coming down out of heaven from my God. And I will also write on him a new name. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And a promise here that our names will be written in heaven, and that nothing can take that away. Nothing can take it away. What a promise. And so we have the story of two churches this morning. We have the story of Sardis that seems to be doing all the things they're supposed to do. They do church well, but they're not doing it with the heart of God. They're not living the way that God would have them to live. The joy has gone out of their worship. They scooted too far over in the truck. And then we have Philadelphia that is keeping on the way God had planned for them to keep on, staying close to the Holy Spirit in obedience to God's will. And he praises them for that, but he tells them just to keep on. We have the story of two churches here and of people today. I hope that we're more like Philadelphia. That whatever path that we're set on, that we serve it with joy and grace and love and understanding and care. Not a dead church like Sardis. So where are we at in that relationship that we have with God this morning? Where are we at in that relationship that we have him as the letters went out to the churches? Where do we see ourselves this morning? But in every one of the churches presented, there's always a promise. The promise is, even for Sardis, if you repent and turn away, you can get back on the right path. And your names will be written on that pillar in heaven. So I don't know where we're at this morning as a church, or as where we're at as a people in our church today. I'm a firm believer today that we have churches that are banging the cymbals, but for the wrong reason. Maybe as a church we need to search our hearts and bring glory to God. So this morning, as I brought the two churches, and oh, by the way, I apologize this morning. I didn't have 49 slides. I'm picking on them. You guys, it's not about a religion. It's all about a relationship. One church had it, and one church didn't. Maybe they never had it. Maybe they lost it. But it's really about a relationship. We want to be the church that God wants us to be. We have to rekindle the fire of his love. We need to deal with the sin in our lives and draw closer back to our Lord and Savior. We want to be a light to this community. We have to learn to love people the way God loved us. We need to see people the way God sees people. Understand that the same Jesus that died for us died for them. We need to reach down and pick people up and quit pushing people down. That's what God is calling us to do. We need to be more like the Church of Philadelphia. Maybe this morning, as you heard me bring God's word this morning, you realize that you might be one of those people that knows about Jesus, has learned about Jesus, maybe even taught about Jesus, but you don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. I'm here to tell you this morning, there's only one way for your sins to be forgiven, and that's through the blood of the Lamb. And that Lamb was named Jesus. And don't be embarrassed. You may have served this church for 45 years and realize this morning you don't have a personal relationship. I'd rather you be embarrassed before the congregation than be embarrassed before God. when he says, I don't know your name. And I believe I know the heart of the church this morning. If you came forward, they're not going to look at you in condemnation that you've served all these years. They're going to be rejoicing that there's another saint in heaven. Or maybe you're here this morning and you don't know Christ at all. Maybe this morning your heart's been tugged on. And you realize that you want that relationship. Well, today, you can have it. Today, you can accept Christ as your Lord and Savior. Maybe today, you just got something that's burdened on your heart this morning. You want to bring it up here to the altar and pray over it. I'll encourage you to do that. But let me pray. Father God, we thank you this morning for an opportunity to come to your house and to study your word, Father, and to look at the churches, the letters that were given out to the seven churches, Father. The word that you revealed to John. And in this, Father, there's both. We're not better than either one. But there's lessons that we can learn as we look at God's churches, Father, to the church of Sardis that somehow or another lost their heart. And Father, I pray that we never, ever lose our heart. Draw us closer to you. And for the church of Philadelphia, Father, that seemed to be doing things the way you would have them do it, help us to be steadfast in our faith with you. Always keeping our eyes on you. Maybe, Father, we always remember the main thing, to keep the main thing, the main thing, and the main thing is your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for blessing us here this morning, Father. We thank you for laying your hands upon this congregation. We thank you for our pastor and his wife. May you be glorified today. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Can you stand?
The Father's arms.
Amen. Listen, those seven churches, they preach, don't they? It is powerful, the letters that Christ would write to these churches. And I thank Pastor Buddy for delivering a powerful, powerful word. That word that, you know, there's a lot of times it's easy for us to get so used to the rhythm of church and the pattern of church and the worship of, like, not of church, but within church. And we just kind of coast, and a week becomes 3 weeks, becomes 3 months, becomes 3 years, and we just kind of say, well, you know, it's just kind of okay. And there's nothing ordinary about what happens in this place. There's nothing ordinary that happens within the life of a believer. And if we've got to a place of ordinary, the word that Pastor Buddy has that he brought this morning of rekindling that love, that matters. You know, a lot of time where he said, you know, take a look at the bench. I love that analogy. But take a look at the bench, and Jesus is like, I didn't move. That's a powerful word for us, because it is so easy for us to get into the pattern of church that we forget the place of it and who we are in it, that we are not a building, but that we're a bride, and that we're in a deep relationship with a Savior. And that's a powerful invitation for us week after week. And so thank you so much for reminding us of that this morning. And thank you for the preparation that you put into that. And for us, as we're about to depart, I have just a handful of announcements for you. First of all, Refuge, the retreat is coming up. It's just a couple weeks away. Today is the last day. It's the early bird deadline. If you want to get the early bird rate for the retreat, midnight's your deadline. Otherwise, it goes up to the normal rate after that. So please go ahead and sign up. We have at the table opportunities for people to kind of plug in and serve. It's not to say that there's not opportunities throughout the church here, but this is the last week for the table. And so if you'd like to stop by the table and grab some information, see what some of the ministries are, maybe put down some information or request some information by filling out the interest form. The interest form does not commit you to serving, but it's just saying, hey, I'd like to learn more about this ministry or this ministry. So make sure you stop by that table for some information about some of the different places that you might be able to plug in. Also, if you've been visiting with us for a little bit and you'd like more information about what it is to be a member, what it is to be baptized, what it is to plug into our church, not just from a serving perspective, but just where can I grow in my faith and what opportunities are there for me to learn more about Christ here at the church. If you're new with us, we have a class that's going to be next Sunday. It's called Exploring My Next Steps. It's 5 p.m. It's going to be in room 122, so please stop by that class. That is one of the, it's a great landing point. If you're trying to figure out what do I do next or what's next, that's a great place to start. And so Exploring My Next Steps is going to be next week, 5 p.m., room 122. And then the last announcement I have is 2 weeks from yesterday. In 2 weeks, we're going to have an end of summer party. We're going to have big water slides for the kids that are on some inflatables. So we're going to turn some inflatables into water slides. We're going to have hamburgers and hot dogs. We're going to have lots of opportunity for us to be able to fellowship. We're going to have a cornhole tournament. We're going to have games. We just really want to relax and have some fun together as a church. Just sit around, build some relationships, talk, laugh. So come on out. Invite some friends if you'd like to bring them out. It'd be a wonderful time to be able to just wrap up the summer and get ready for fall. As Laura likes to say, we're just a couple weeks away from the burr months. And in our house, we look forward to the burr months. They're some of our favorites. And so but we're going to wrap up summer together as the church family, August 24th, 4 to 7. And so I hope you mark your calendar for that. And so those are the announcements that I have this morning. We will go ahead and wrap up our time with the singing of our doxology. And we also have small group in second hour. And so that is still to come. And so thank you all for being with us this morning. Laura and I will be available in the lobby at the Connection Center if you have any questions or would like to learn more about our church, or maybe just want someone to pray with you. We would love to do that with you. So anyhow, let's close. Miss Serena.